Hello everyone. In the previous video, we talked about the mean squared error or MSE. And I explained that in statistical learning, you start from a model that gives you the F hat, the approximation for your regression function. And then you can determine for each model the MSE for your data set. If you then have different models, you can choose the model that has the smallest MSE, the model that fits your data the best. And that data set that you use to compare all the models based on the MSE is called the training data set. It helps to train your models. However, if we then find that we have a model with a small training MSE, well, that is actually not a real surprise, because we have designed our selection of the model such that the MSE is as small as possible. So if we select among several good models the one with the smallest MSE, we shouldn't be that surprised that we find a small MSE. That is just because we picked the model in that way. For example, assume we have historical stock market data. We are following different stocks over the last couple of years. And the goal is to predict if a stock goes up or down in the future. We want to know, well, should we buy or sell this particular stock? What we have at our disposal to make our predictions, these are the past returns. Then what does a small training MSE mean? Well, the MSE is the error or the fit of your model on the data. In this case, what is data? Data are the past returns. So a small training MSE means that we can accurately predict what happened in the past. However, the goal is to predict the future. So the question is then, if we have a small training MSE, does that help us? Does that ensure us that we can also predict the future? And unfortunately, the answer is no. If we have a small training MSE, we can start predicting the past. But how to find a model that is also able to predict the future? Well, we need some additional steps, and that is what we will describe in this video. The problem with the training MSE and the training dataset is that if we build our model, we start looking at the training data set. And then we will tune our model, we will change our model, we will jump to another model each time we try to improve the MSE. So we are aligning our model with the training data set. And that means that if we then say, well, we have a good model because it has a small training MSE, well, that is not a real good reason. What we need to understand if our model is a good model is what we call a validation set. A validation set is an independent data set, independent from the training data set, and it's a data set which was not used to estimate the model. It means that the model did not see the validation set. The model saw the training data set. The training data set was used to build the model. So once you have the model, you want to apply it in an independent situation, and that is the validation set. In order to create a validation set in an artificial way, what you do is, well, you have all your data and you split your data in two parts. One is a training data set. You build your model based on that set, and then you use the remaining validation set to test your model. So then you automatically have one data set that is used to build the model, and the model did not yet see the other part of the data. And for example, you can use 80% to train the model, 20% to validate the model, or instead of the 80-20 split, you can use 70-30, that depends a bit. There are also more advanced methods like cross-validation that do exactly that, that try to understand how can we apply the model on the validation sets that the model did not yet see. So we will call our validation set xjyj with a v subscript to indicate, well, this is the validation set. And then the validation MSE is the prediction of your model of the response of an observation in the validation set and the observed response of that observation. So we can determine a training MSE, but now we can also use the validation MSE. If the validation MSE is small, well, that is a good sign, because that means that our model performs well when we apply it on data that is new for the model. So in our building process for the model, we start with the training MSE. We try to find a model with a small training MSE. That's step one. If the MSE on the training set is large, well, it's not a good model. However, if the training MSE is small, we cannot conclude that it will be a good model. It can still be a bad model, but we cannot directly reject it. We have to go to the next step. The next step is to determine a validation MSE, to apply the model on a data set that is completely new to the model. Then we look at the validation MSE. If that MSE is also small, then it shows that the model is able to perform well in a real challenge. When we apply it in a situation it did not yet encounter in the training stage. If the validation MSE is large, it means that, well, the model is not able to predict new unknown observations accurately. What we can do then is we can go back to the training set. So we have a model that does not perform well, so we have to go back to the training data set. We will improve our model. We will make sure it still has a small training MSE. And once we have the improved model, we can again apply it on the validation MSE to see if now it performs better. So we have the training set, we have the validation set, but once you are working with the validation set, you can also go back to the training set to improve your model and test it again on the validation set. We use the training set to build the model. Then we have the validation set to check if the model performs well on new data. But if that is not the case, we go back to the training set and start over again, improve the model, and then check if the improved model is working well on the validation set. So we build our complete model using the training and the validation set. And if all these steps are completed, we end up with a validated model. A model that performs well on the data and on new data. But then we maybe want to put our model to a final test. So we want to have another, what we call a test set, to see how well does that validated model work on completely new data. When we have, for example, different validated models. For example, if you do a competition, a Kaggle competition is a good example. You ask different groups to build a model for a given data set. So you have data available, groups can build their model, then the final test, the model selection, where we determine which group is winning the competition, then we give a final test set and we apply each of the different models on that test set and see which one has the lowest test MSE. The one with the lowest test MSE, that is the winner of the competition. That's really the best model. Assume our model has to save the day. Our model has to solve this huge problem. Of course, we are not going to throw our model unprepared into the battle. No, we first say to a model, you have to be prepared, you have to get stronger before you can start the battle. So we will send our model to the gym to make it stronger. And after a lot of exercising, you get a fitted model. A model that is prepared for battle. But before we put it to the final battle, we say, well, let's validate the model. Let's test if the model performs well when it has new observations. So we throw our model in this tournament. And if the outcome is bad, if, for example, our model lost each fight, well, we say, well, you have to go back to the gym. You have to go back to the gym, and with everything you know on this last tournament, try to improve yourself. Try to check what are your weak points. And then we repeat all these steps here, training, validation, until we think, well, now we have a very good validated model. It is this model we will then put to the final test. And if we can survive this test, then we conclude we have a good model. Let us now apply the ideas of training and validation set on our situation with the KNN method. In our situation, we have only one data set, so we have to split our data set in two parts. One will be used as training, the other will be used as validation. So we take 800 observations randomly sampled to be our training set. And that's why we use here the sample function. The sample function takes out of the 1000 observations randomly 800 observations. And the train vector contains a number of the observations that belongs to the training set. So then the training predictors and the training responses are from X and for Y of my whole dataset, but I only keep the indices in the vector train. The remaining observations are put in the validation set. And I can do that very simple by R by saying, well, look at the vector X with all the observations. We take all the observations except, that's why I put the minus here, all the observations that are already in my training data set. And then you have the test X values and the test Y values. If you then apply your KNN model with KS50 on your training and on your validation set, you find that your training MSE is 1.15%, which is close to 1.1% we had before. The validation MSE is 1.20. And then you see that the validation MSE is larger than the training MSE, which makes sense because you train your model on the training data sets, but then you cannot change your model afterwards to get a good validation MSE. So in most situations, you will find a training set that is smaller, that has a smaller MSE than the validation set. Of course, it can happen. That is the other way around, but mostly you have training MSE is smaller than validation MSE. In this plot, the blue dots is the validation set, the observations in the validation set. And for each observation, say I take this observation here, I determine for that observation the X value. For example, the X value is 0.5. Then I'm going to predict, what is my prediction for that observation? And assume that prediction is exactly this value here. So I have my predicted response, I have my observed response. The main difference between this plot and the very similar plot we had in the previous video is that in order to get this green prediction, I'm looking for the k observations that are closest to X is equal to 0.5 that are in my training set. So for example, if I look in this plot, I see that this observation and say this observation, all these observations here of my validation set are very close to X equal to 0.5, but I will not use these observations. I'm going to determine the X value of my validation observation. Once I know that X value, I will go to my training set and choose the K observations from the training set that are closest to that X value. In this case, X equal to 0.5. And then I will determine my prediction based on the observed responses in the training set. And therefore, if you compare the observation in my validation set, this point here, and the green point that you have here, my prediction, In order to make the prediction, I did not use any information you have in this plot. Because I jumped to the training data set, did my prediction there, and then put that prediction in this plot. That's the idea of the validation set. In the validation set, your prediction is not using any information of that validation set. In the KNN method, you have to determine what is K, the number of neighbors you will put in your NK set. And so far, this K was assumed to be fixed. We put it equal to 50. And K, you can change. You can put K equal to 60 or 40. It's called a tuning parameter. Because if we determine the training MSE and we change K, we will see that K is decreasing in function of the training MSE. So you cannot determine the K by minimizing the training MSE. However, what we can do is we can search for a K that has the smallest validation MSE. So we can find an optimal KNN model by minimizing the validation MSE. If we determine the validation MSE in function of K, we get this plot here. And I hope that you see the clear difference with the plot we had in the previous video, where we had the training MSE in function of K. The training MSE in function of K, when we start from a large K, we decrease K, the training MSE was always becoming smaller and smaller and smaller. In this case, still, if we start from a large number for K, and we decrease that number, we include a lower number of neighbors, the validation MSE is going down. Why is that? If you have many neighbors, then of course, if you try to predict, for example, the response with x equal to 0.5, you take 80 neighbors, you also have neighbors that have a predictor variable x equal to, say, 1. And the data you have in the neighborhood of x equal to 1, well, that's not really representative for the situation x equal to 0.5. So it means you are being too general and not specific enough to understand what happens in your specific x value. That's why you have a large validation MSE. That's why you have a large training MSE if k is large. So you have to decrease your k, make it smaller. And then you see indeed, well, your k is going down, down, down. Your validation MSE is going down, down, down. So that is good news. However, there is some point, say somewhere here, after which if you decrease even more, your validation MSE is going up again. Note that if we decrease even in this point the K even more, the training MSE will still be going down. But the validation MSE is going up. Why is the validation MSE in this region going up? If you take only very few observations in your set NK, so K very small, K equal to 5 for example, you take only 5 neighbors around your predictor variable X, then you are too specific. You are trying to come very, very, very close to your training data. But then you are applying that information that was very specific to your training data set, you are applying it on your validation data set, which is different. It's similar but different, and because you are too attached to your training data set, applying that same model on your validation MSE will result in big errors and therefore also a large MSE. So what we see in this plot is, for large case, you are too general, not specific enough. For very small case, you are too specific to your data, training data. So the optimal value for your K is somewhere here, say around 20. There you have a good balance between using enough data so that you are not too attached to your training data set, but still not using too many data points such that you get too general and you are not specific enough for the region you are looking at.